Thank Brother Craig for giving me the opportunity to speak. I know how much he loves this pulpit and this place, and he doesn't give these opportunities away very often, and so I appreciate having the opportunity. I want to say another thank you as well to so many of you who helped this past week in World Changers. Some of you gave money, many of you prayed, some of you served breakfast at a terribly awful early hour. Dinner, you took lunches, you helped out on work sites. You did so much. It takes so much for that to happen. And over the week, we were able to work on over 20 homes and different ministries, had many gospel conversations in the community, and at least two people that we know were saved during the week. And so none of that could have happened if you hadn't helped us. So we appreciate all that you did to be there with us. You know, I think all of us like pictures. And if you're like me, if you're over 30, you can remember when pictures used to be a lot harder to come by than they are today. You know, we had some little dinky camera that we had to fast forward with our finger, and then you had to take up the whole roll because you didn't want to waste it because it was expensive. And then you had to take them down to Eckerd's or somewhere, Walmart, and get them developed. But today, we all carry these phones around with us, and so we just have pictures everywhere. You know, I'm not on Facebook a lot, but when I do, I primarily just look at the pictures. You got to have a really good picture for me to stop and look at what you said. And then if you want me to like what you said, it better be pretty good, and it better be real good if you want me to comment, because most times I just scroll through the pictures. I think the reason we like pictures so much is because it helps us understand. We got a new little countertop appliance yesterday, and I was trying to put it together, figure out how it worked, and it had pictures, which I need, to show me where to plug up this hose and where to put that and all that. Pictures help us understand what we're trying to learn. And in 2 Timothy chapter 2, Paul gives us five pictures of effective Christian leadership. Now, he's doing this to Timothy, his protege, his son in the faith, near the end of his life, knowing that he's, in a sense, going to pass the baton on to Timothy as leader in Asia Minor. And while he does it in the context of one apostle to another young minister who's going to be a pastor, all the things that he tells Timothy apply to me and you as well. He talks about a teacher. He talks about a soldier. He talks about a farmer. He talks about an athlete. He talks about the ultimate champion, Jesus, and even himself a little bit. But he gives us these pictures to help us understand how to be an effective Christian leader. And while not all of us are called to be a pastor or even a Sunday school teacher or a small group leader, all of us are called to pass the faith on. And that's the heart of what Paul is talking about. So if you've got your Bibles, I would encourage you to turn to 2 Timothy chapter 2, and we're going to start reading in verse 1. Paul says, "You therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things that you've heard from me among many witnesses, commit these to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. You therefore must endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. And also, if anyone competes in athletics, he's not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. The hardworking farmer must be the first to partake of the crops. Consider what I say, and may the Lord give you understanding in all things. Remember that Jesus Christ of the seed of David was raised from the dead according to my gospel, for which I suffer trouble as an evildoer, even to the point of chains. But the word of God is not changed. Therefore, I endure all things for the sake of the elect, that they also may obtain the salvation which is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory." So Paul, again, near the end of his life, he's trying to pour his life into young Timothy. and help him understand what he needs to do to be an effective Christian leader. And he tells us all of these things as well. First of all, he talks about the teacher's task. He says that all of us need to be teachers. Again, we may not all be called to lead a group in teaching, but what we learn, Christ expects us to pass on to others. When Paul tells him to be strong, that's a command. He's not saying, hey, if you get around to it, do this. He's saying, be strong in the grace in Christ Jesus. Because Paul wanted him to understand that it was the grace of God that enabled him, Paul, to be a great teacher, a great apostle. And it was that same grace, that same power that was going to help Timothy. That word's a command, but it's also passive, which is kind of paradoxical because you're supposed to do this, but then it's a force acting outside of you. And so Paul is just reinforcing the idea that Timothy needed to do his part, but the power came from God. The power came from the outside. And Paul tells him, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. That same grace that brought Timothy to salvation was going to help him be the teacher that Paul wanted him to be. And it's also a present verb, which means that it's a continuous action. This is something that never finishes. Now, you know, in the secular world, let's say we're a car salesman. We may sell cars for 40, 50 years, but at some point, we're probably going to back off, retire, go home, enjoy our grandkids, travel, do whatever. In the Christian life, that retirement age never comes. As long as we're breathing, we need to be passing on the things that we've learned to other people. It's a continuous thing. That's what Paul wanted Timothy to understand. To be an effective teacher, first of all, we have to continue to learn. We have to continue to take in and learn from others. Paul said, "In these things which you have heard from me among many witnesses." So Timothy had the most amazing teacher of all. He had Paul. He saw him every day. And so for years, he traveled with Paul and heard about the church, heard about Christ, heard this great theology that the Holy Spirit was giving to Paul to give to the early church. But he heard more than theology. He saw it lived out in Paul's life. He was there in Philippi when Paul and Silas got scourged and put in jail. And you know, Paul was a Roman citizen. He could have claimed that and gotten out of all that. But there's a good chance if he had done that, the crowd would have gone after young Timothy because he wasn't a Roman citizen. And so in that, Timothy saw that strength, that courage. He learned volumes from Paul in the way of doctrine and theology. But he learned more in watching him live, watching him how he treated people, watching him how he loved people, watching him how he poured into people. And that's what Paul wanted Timothy to get. And he says, you heard from me among many witnesses. Think of the people that hung out with Paul. Luke, who wrote Luke and Acts. Peter, Barnabas, all these people had poured their lives into young Timothy. And Paul was saying, all these people have helped you learn. You need to continue to learn, continue to take in. A friend of mine that I think a lot of says that leaders are readers. Because to lead, you've got to continue to learn and continue to stay on top of things. This morning as we met in Brother Craig's office to pray. And thinking about this, I kind of looked around and there's no less than 6 books on his desk that are set there, I'm assuming, so that he can begin to read them. Well, I met Brother Craig, I believe in 1984. That's when I started college at the Baptist College of Florida. Now, I started when I was 12. I'm not nearly as old as Brother Craig. But I enrolled in school there, and he was a couple years ahead of me, and he was also working at my father-in-law's church, so I met him. So he's been at this for over 4 decades, and he's got 6 books sitting on his desk in there right now. We've got to continue to learn. We never get to the point as a Christian that we can lay this aside and say, you know what? I pretty much got a handle on it. Right. We're never going to get a handle on this. We're always going to be learning. And that's what Paul wanted Timothy to do, was to continue to learn. But then he told him, continue to teach. And these things you've heard from me among many witnesses, commit to faithful men who'll be able to teach others also. That word commit has the idea of depositing something really valuable. Paul had poured his life into Timothy, had given him everything. And he wanted Timothy to treat that like gold and deposit it in other people's lives. And Paul would tell us the same thing, to, yes, take in all you can, but don't hang on to it. Give it to others. Teach it to others. He had that special entrustment that he had entrusted to Timothy that he wanted to trust to others. He says to faithful men, to spiritual men, to men who are going to take this and not squander it, to men who are going to take this and they're going to pass it on to others. So he says, I want you to continue to learn, continue to teach. But then he moves to a soldier. In verse 3, he says, you therefore must endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. Now think about who Paul was talking about. The Roman soldiers of that day were the best trained, the best equipped, the most effective. They were the by far the most mighty fighting force in the world. And Paul knew them. Paul knew them up close and personal. He'd been chained to them. He had been imprisoned by them. And he says, I want you to be a good soldier. And the first thing he says about that, he says, endure hardship. He says, I want you to continue to endure. And he said, with me, Paul wanted Timothy to understand, look back at my life. It's not all been a piece of cake. So join in this with me. That word to endure hardship has the idea of taking your share of the rough treatment along with other people. And so think about a soldier. Many of you have served in the military. It's not a 9-to-5 job. It's 24/7. Even when you're off, you can get called at a moment's notice, and you're supposed to be there. The little bit of time I was in the Air Force when I got out, I was on inactive reserve for 7 years. And that whole time I thought, boy, I hope I don't get that call. But that's what a soldier is all about. Everything that he has, his body, his skills, his weapons, everything belongs to the service that he's enlisted in. And whenever that call comes, that soldier has to respect that and show up for duty. Jesus said this in Luke, foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. And so Jesus was saying, you know what? I've given it all up. I don't have a home. I don't have a wife. I don't have anything because God sent me here for a purpose. And Paul was trying to help Timothy to understand that it was about being all in. It was about giving everything you've got. He said, I want you to continue to endure. But then he said, I want you to continue to untangle, is the way I've put it. He says, no one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life. I didn't think unentangles was a word, so I just put untangle, but continue to untangle. And what Paul's saying when he's talking about entangle is the idea of weaving something together. And when he says Timothy not to do that, he's saying, don't get tangled up in the affairs of life. Don't get tangled up in business or whatever to the point that it drags you down, to the point that it makes you ineffective as a leader, as a Christian. And that word that means to weave, it's on purpose. It's by design. It's willing. So Paul's saying, don't do that. Be careful to keep yourself free of other entanglements. And, you know, a lot of these things are innocent in themselves. Take athletics, which I grew up and I believe athletics helped me grow up as a person, helped me become a man, helped me to understand how to work with other people. I loved athletics. I still enjoy watching athletics. But if we're not careful, we can get so entangled in going to ball games or maybe travel ball or just thinking that we've got to pour everything into it. And we can very easily let that entanglement pull us away from being the soldier that God's called us to be. And so Paul is telling young Timothy, don't get entangled in the affairs of everyday life. Jesus said, take up my cross and follow me. He didn't say take up my portfolio or take up my my business or my hobbies or whatever. He said, take up my cross and follow me. Paul said, I do not consider my life of any account as dear to myself in order that I may finish the course and the ministry which I received from the Lord Jesus. Paul tells Timothy, as you mature, continue to untangle those things that cause you to be less effective. And then finally, he said, continue to please. He says that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. There's nothing more important when you're a soldier than pleasing your commanding officer, because in a very real way, he holds your life in your hand. And our commander is Christ Jesus, who loves us and made us and has a purpose for us. And so we ought to do everything that we can to please our commander, who's Jesus. We all want to hear at the end of the day, well done, good and faithful slave. You were faithful in a few things. I put you in charge of many things. Enter the joy of your master. And so we have to do everything we can to continue to please our commander. The thing that probably fights against that the most is trying to please other people. We can all get wrapped up in trying to please the crowd, or maybe just trying to please one person that we're trying to impress. That can lead us down a bad path. I saw this from Chuck Swindoll. A good soldier intentionally avoids entangling himself in distractions so he can focus his energy on accomplishing the goal set by his commanding officer. He's not concerned with the stock market. He's not concerned with the latest sports scores. He doesn't entangle himself in politics. He remains focused on victory because a distracted soldier is a dead soldier. Continue to please the one that enlisted you. Paul said, I need you to be a good soldier. He said, you're going to have to endure. You're going to have to continue to please the one who called you, and you're going to have to continue to untangle yourself from the word, from the world. When I went to the Air Force, I had very little idea of what I was getting into, but I remember we got there, and of course, about the first thing they did was cut all your hair off, and that was not a pretty me. I mean, I looked like a Holocaust survivor or something like that. And then they gave us all this stuff. They gave us shorts and pants and T-shirts and all this stuff. Well, then they took everything away. They took everything I brought with me away, down to my socks and underwear. They took everything. And I had to wear their stuff because they didn't want me thinking about home. They wanted me to be on their team and with their stuff and forget my stuff. They didn't want me to be entangled with the affairs of what I'd left behind. And that's what Paul was telling Timothy. Don't let this world, there are a lot of things in the world that are okay in themselves, but if we obsess over them, they can entangle us. They can keep us from being effective. And if we're not careful, they can even lead us away from serving because we get so busy doing things that may be good, but not the best things. Paul says, be a good soldier. endure, untangle, and continue to please your master. And then he looks at an athlete. In verse 5, he says, "And if anyone competes in athletics, he's not crowned unless he competes according to the rules." You know, Paul ministered and wrote in the day of when the Olympics had just kind of come about. And so he's got that mind, that idea in his mind. And, you know, they competed for a crown. It was typically a woven crown of leaves, of parsley, of something, a wreath that they would put on their heads. And typically it was given for not just athletics, but for public service, for military service. And of course, in the Olympic Games, and Paul is talking about that crown, not that you win an Olympics, but that God would give you at the end of your life. And so he says, to compete in athletics, you don't get crowned unless you compete according to the rules. So he says, continue to compete. And he comes back to this in this picture. That word compete means struggle, wrestle, really work at it. Paul, over and over again in this, and we'll see it in the farmer too, Paul reminds young Timothy, this is the most important thing you'll ever do, but it's not a cakewalk. It's not easy. You got to struggle. You got to compete. You got to work hard. It takes great determination. A lot of times that difference between first place and second place is not so much the athletic ability as it is the determination, the will, the heart. The coach that I used to play for, he called it, you got to have heart. You know, you got to really want it. Athletic ability is great, but it will only take you so far. Think about the tortoise and the hare. The hare was faster, the hare was better equipped, but the tortoise stayed at it over and over again. He just kept going, and because of that, he finished the first race. And of course, we don't compete against one another. We compete against the flesh. We compete against those things that would pull us away. In Ephesians, Paul says, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Our goal is to finish the race, to get that crown that God has for us, but to do it by staying to the rules. Paul says, continue to compete, continue to struggle. And then he says, continue to comply. In Paul's day, when an athlete showed up for an Olympic-type game, he had to swear before Zeus that he'd been training for at least 10 months. And then, just like today's athletics, there were different rules that you had to abide by. And if they didn't abide by the rules, if it was a slight infraction, you'd get a pretty stiff fine. If it was a big infraction, you'd get scourged in front of the public. I think that'd be a great thing to add to professional football. You know, if you hold somebody, take them over the sidelines and beat them up or something. They wouldn't do it again. But that's what Paul's talking about. He says you've got to obey the rules. You've got to do the things that are important. And you know, we know Paul started this off, said, be strong in the grace. And there was not a better proponent of grace than Paul. Clay read that passage that we all know out of Ephesians chapter 2. For by grace you've been saved, that not of yourselves. But sometimes, if we're not careful, we can take grace to the extreme and think that means there are no rules. Well, nothing could be further from the truth. There are certain things that are clear-cut in the Bible that we need to stay away from. Immorality. On the positive side, we need to be kind to people. We need to love people. Those things. Sometimes the Spirit of God has to lead us in those gray areas, but there are some pretty cut and dried things in the Scripture that we have to be careful to follow. And that's what Paul, in different places, Paul told Timothy to flee youthful lust and to keep himself above reproach in every way, because Paul wants Timothy to get the crown. Paul and others talk about that crown in 2 Timothy in chapter 4, just a couple of chapters on. Paul says, it's the crown of righteousness which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who've loved his appearing. Peter says, the unfading crown of glory we will receive when the chief shepherd appears. James says, so the crown of life which the Lord has promised to those who love him. And then finally, John in Revelation, he says, one day, like the 24 elders, we'll fall down at the feet of him who sits on the throne, and we'll worship him who lives forever and ever, and we'll cast our crowns before the throne. Every athlete seeks to win that prize, that whatever it is. They want to win the game. They don't do it just for the fun of it. They do it to win, and to do it, they have to do it according to the rules. To get the crown, we must continue to comply. And that's what Timothy wanted, or that's what Paul wanted young Timothy to understand, that he had to continue to compete, continue to struggle, but also continue to do it by the rules. You know, if you've ever played or watched athletics or you know anything about it, you know, a team can be playing lights out, and one bad play, one bad penalty can turn the tide and let the other team win. And that's what Paul is telling Timothy. And you and I probably know somebody who was on fire, an amazing, influential Christian, and they make a terrible mistake. They break one of those important rules, and it changes their life forever. It deletes their influence. It hurts their testimony. More than that, it hurts the testimony of the church. More than that, it hurts the testimony of our Lord. The King's in the room. And if he's in the room, we've got to do what we need to do to bring him honor and to bring him glory. And so Paul says, be a good athlete and compete according to the rules. And then his next illustration is the farmer. Verse 6, he says, the hard-working farmer must be the first to partake of his crops. He says, the hard-working farmer, he tells Timothy, continue to work. That word hard-working has the idea of intense toil, of sweat, of labor. Again, Paul comes back to this. In the soldier, he said, you got to endure. In the athlete, he said, you got to struggle, you got to compete. And now in the farmer, he says, you got to work hard. It's not when it's convenient for us. The farmer works when it's cold, when it's hot, when it's rainy, when it's dry. He works when the work needs to be done. And that's what Paul is trying to tell young Timothy. And, you know, I grew up, one of my granddads was a pig farmer and the other one was a rancher. And so I grew up around all this agricultural stuff. And I grew up in Central Florida. There were orange trees all around. And, you know, for months and months and months, whether you're working with cows or pigs or oranges or whatever, the farmer or the rancher would put the seed out. He would hoe the weeds. He would feed the animals and all that. You work and work and work and work. And a lot of days are hard and a lot of days are monotonous. But then at the end, there's a reward. And so that's what Paul's trying to help Timothy to understand. And the Christian life's the same way. The work's never done. There's always somebody who's going to need encouragement. There's always somebody who's going to need ministry. There's always going to be somebody who needs the gospel. And Paul's telling young Timothy, continue to work. Continue to work hard. I grew up working a lot on my grandfather's ranch. And the worst job of the whole summer every year was putting up hay. We put up more bales of hay than anybody else in the hand bales of hay. Than anybody else in the state of Florida. And I mean, we'd start early in the morning and work till late at night. And we had this big barn about 40 feet high, and that's where we stacked the hay. And there'd be 7 or 8 guys in the barn. And there would be, you know, somebody be on the floor and then a couple bales up until they got to the roof. And the closer you got to the roof, the closer it got to the temperature of the sun. It was a horrible existence. It was dusty in there. And your break, the way you got to go on break, is you went outside in the hot sun and threw it on the back of the truck. But I remember those old guys there, as we were in there sweating, and I mean, you would just be soaked. And I mean, it just seemed like it was never ending. And they would always say, watch out for that bear, don't get bear caught. And I finally figured out they were talking about heat exhaustion. And they were saying, don't work yourself to the point where, you know, you just collapse. But Paul's wanting Timothy to understand this idea of being a farmer for Christ, of being a leader for Christ, it's hard work. You got to pace yourself, but it's going to be hard, long work. And only at the end are you going to receive that reward. And so he's saying, continue to work hard. But then he tells him to continue to enjoy. He says the farmer ought to be the first one to enjoy the fruits of his crop. You know, probably one of the most rewarding things that we ever experience as a Christian is seeing someone that we've helped along the way do well. Seeing someone that we've shared the gospel with accept that gospel. See somebody that we've helped teach, grow, and begin to teach others. And Paul's saying, yeah, the work's hard, the work's tough, but continue it, and at the end of it, you'll reap a reward. You'll get something that's great. Some of you know that we recently moved out of Lynn Haven up 77 out in Southport. And one of the reasons I wanted to move is I wanted a little bit more space. And I wanted to try growing a garden. I grew up doing that. I hated it when I was a kid because I didn't understand that, you know, you got the reward at the end. But our house was supposed to be ready at Christmas and then March and then April and then May. And now maybe sometime in the next millennial. But as it was like around March, end of March, first of April, I thought, you know, I ought to plant something. So I planted me some tomato plants. I got 5-gallon buckets, put all the stuff in them, and I'd go out there every day and water them and weed them and make sure they were okay. And the first tomato I took off of that, I swear to you, was the best tomato I've ever had in my life. Now, I only got about 4 tomatoes off of 5 plants, but they were really, really good tomatoes. And that's what Paul is trying to get Timothy to understand. It's going to be hard. People are going to be tough on you. But if you hang in there, there's a great reward at the end. And then the last example that Paul gives is an example of what I call the champion. He's used all these human examples, a teacher, a soldier, athlete, farmer. He's led all these human examples, but he brings it back. In the beginning, he said, be strong in the grace of Jesus Christ. And he brings it back to Jesus and he says, remember that Jesus Christ, the seed of David, was raised from the dead according to my gospel, for which I suffer as an evildoer, even to the point of chains. But the word of God is not changed. Therefore, I endure all things for the sake of the elect, that they may also obtain salvation, which is in Christ Jesus, which is eternal glory. Paul says, continue to hope. There's hope in the gospel. In 1 Peter, it said, in 1 Peter 1:3-5, it says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to the living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible, undefiled, and does not fade away. Paul said in Romans, for whatever things were written before you were written for our learning, that through the patience and comfort of the scriptures, we might have hope. Brother Craig has used that as sort of our motto around here. Paul's telling young Timothy, continue to hope. Yes, it's going to be hard. Yes, there's going to be tough days, but that hope is out there. And he tells him, continue to share. He says, the word of God is not changed. You know, Timothy had seen everything Paul had been through. And Paul's saying, they beat me. They scourged me. They stoned me and left me for dead. But look what the Word of God has done. We've planted churches all over the known world. We've brought Gentiles into the kingdom. The Word of God can't be stopped. Men over the centuries have tried to stomp out the Word of God, and all of them were a failure at it. Hebrews tells us it's a living word. It's quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and the joints and marrow. It's a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Man may deny the Word of God, but it will never be bound. So he tells him to continue to share. But then at the end, he says, continue to glory. In Philippians, Paul said this, "Let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking on the form of a bondservant, and coming in the likeness of man, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. Therefore, God also has highly exalted him and given him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow of those in heaven and those on earth and those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus is Lord to the glory of God the Father." Again, Timothy's kind of bearing this thought, or Paul is trying to burn this thought into Timothy's mind. There's going to be tough times. There's going to be times when you were humiliated. There's going to be times when you were taken advantage of. All of that happened to Jesus. But Jesus was exalted and given the name that's above every name. And you know, there's a lot of this health and wealth stuff out there that if you do right, God will bless you. And certainly that's a principle in Scripture. But there's going to be times when we don't feel very blessed. There's going to be times when we feel persecuted. There's going to be times when we felt beat down. And it's good for us to remember that Jesus went through all of that. Paul is telling young Timothy, continue to share, continue to hope, continue to bring glory to God. That's our ultimate reality. That's what we're here for. You know what all of these different illustrations have in common? The teacher, the soldier, the athlete, the farmer. None of them do it on their own. You can do a little bit of, you can grow 5 tomato plants on your own at a house and get 4 tomatoes off of them. But if you're going to farm in any big way, you got to have help. A soldier, you know, at one time the army used the slogan, a soldier of one. That sounds cool, but if there's 100 of them and one of you, it's not going to turn out good. You know, typically a teacher teaches one subject or one grade or a part of it or something like that. And most athletes are a part of a team. God never intended for us to do this by ourselves. God intended us to link together and work together to encourage one another, to love one another, to help one another. And the best way that we do that at First Baptist Church is in Sunday schools. You knew I was going to get that in there someplace. But that's true. You can come and sit in here and hear some of the best preaching that you can hear anywhere around, as long as you didn't show up today. But when Brother Craig's here, you can hear great preaching every single week. But if you walk out that door and never go to a Bible study class, to a small group, to a discipleship group, you're never going to get to know people. You're never going to fellowship. And chances are, you're not going to grow a lot as a Christian. We all need each other, and that's what Paul is trying to help young Timothy understand. He's telling him, hey, you're on this team. You're fixing to be the captain of the team. I need you to work hard. I need you to do these things so that you can be effective. Would you stand, please? Heads bowed, eyes closed, no one looking around. If you're here today and you've never asked Christ into your heart, God wants you to be on a part of His family. And so I would encourage you to today come and ask Christ into your heart. If you're a guest and you've just been visiting and God is leading you to become a part of this church family, I would encourage you to make that decision. If you need prayer, if there's another decision God's calling you to make, I would encourage you to respond to that call this morning. Father, I thank you that you left us such perfect pictures of what you want us to be. Help us to take those pictures, make them a part of our life, and be everything that you've created us to be. Heads bowed, no one looking around. If God's speaking to your heart, I would pray and encourage you to come and respond to the call of Christ.